side skirts, diffusers, vortex generators, canards? This is Aerodynamics Part Two, Son of Aerodynamics. Now that we've learned the aerodynamic basics of drag and lift and how splitters, spoilers, and wings work, we can talk about what all those other cool aero things are doing. First, just a quick review.
Previously on Science Garage.
We saw that drag is the force air exerts against a car as it moves, while lift is the perpendicular force exerted by the air on the car. Today, we're mostly concerned with lift and its better half, downforce. Now how about that air? Damn! Air dam. The air dam usually has a couple of jobs. It directs more air over the top of the car than underneath to reduce lift, while also diverting air to the radiator to keep your car from overheating. On a sports car or a race car, the air dam is often designed to also shoot air directly into the intake, intercoolers, or oil coolers. It might route air through some ducts in the brakes to help cool those off too. The air dam also cuts down on overall drag, even on a boxy vehicle. Without it, the air would be tripped up by all the blocky shapes you usually find hiding behind that smooth bodywork on the front. On the corners of a race car's air dam, you might find canards, which are also called dive planes or dive plates. I don't know about you, but the word canard makes me think of ducks. No? That's just me? Canards are usually flat, wedge-shaped, and angled upward toward the back of the car. They direct the air that moves around the side of the air dam upwards, which creates a teensy-weensy bit of downforce. It's not much because they're so small, but it's enough to help fine-tune the balance between downforce on the front tires and the rear tires. Canards can also be used to deflect air around the front tires because they can be a source of drag, or they can be used to direct more air up into the wing's path at the back. Look, if you want to get super serious about downforce, it's the stuff that isn't as obvious as a sick front fascia or a shopping cart wing that can make the biggest difference. Underneath your car, there's a whole lot of nooks and crannies and junk like brake lines and exhaust pipes, and they're all meshing up the airflow. Adding a smooth undertray to cover up all that stuff goes a long way to reducing turbulence and drag. It lets the air move below the car much more quickly, and that reduces the air pressure and can enhance the downforce. But add a diffuser, and now we're really making sausage. I mean, downforce. A diffuser is typically a rear undertray shaped to make a gradually bigger space at the back of the car. But some race cars have front diffusers too. It activates what's called a VENTURI effect, which is when a fluid speeds up as it flows through a more constricted area, like the space under your car. And remember Bernoulli's principle that says a fast-moving fluid has lower pressure? Yup! That means even more downforce. As the space at the back of the car gradually increases in size thanks to the diffuser, all the fast-moving low-pressure air from underneath the car rushes up to fill that space. This helps draw even more air across the underside of your car. When it gets to the expansion area, it slows down and gains pressure. With high pressure surrounding the car on all sides and a lot less pressure underneath, an overall vacuum effect occurs and it sucks the car down to the road. Now, that slowed down air can smoothly join back up with the slower, higher pressure air flowing all around the car. This gentle reunion reduces drag at the back, which results in even more downforce. Keeping the air flowing effortlessly without turbulence is what makes all of this work so well. So vertical dividers called strakes are placed in the diffuser to help keep the air orderly. As we learned in our first aero video, downforce from splitters and wings usually comes at the expense of a lot more drag, but adding a smooth undertray and a well-designed diffuser can reduce drag. So together, they're one of the most important ways to increase downforce. Like Nolan without a glass of milk, one without the other won't produce the desired effect. All right, we've created an area of higher pressure all around the top of the car and an area of really low pressure underneath. We're good to go, right? Wait! Now all that high pressure air wants to rush into the low pressure area. And that is exactly what we don't want. And that is what side skirts are for. The ideal side skirts extend as close to the ground as possible to block that high pressure air from sneaking back under the car and around the sides. That would increase lift and ruin the downforce that we just worked so hard to create. One of the most ingenious applications of underbody aerodynamics was Jim Hall's Chaparral 2J race car. The Can-Am series had just banned tall wings and moving aero devices for the 1970 season. So aero pioneer Hall developed some creative workarounds for his new cars. Lexan side skirts were integrated with the suspension to maintain a constant 1-inch clearance with the ground, even around turns or over bumps. And its big, boxy booty were two big fans, driven by their own two-stroke, two-cylinder engine. The fans constantly pulled air through the underbody of the car, creating so much of a vacuum that the 2J produced up to 1.5 G's of downforce. But since the Chaparral 2J's fans moved air independently of the car's speed, it produced about the same amount of downforce at low speeds as it did at high speeds. This meant it could do lap times a full 2 seconds faster than the next fastest cars. Competitors really didn't like that, nor did they like all the dust and rocks that the fans threw in their faces. His car was banned after just one season. Last but not least are those little VORTEX generators, and we're gonna talk about them in Mitsubishi Evo in Civic Type R terms, not F1 terms. Because let's be honest, you're not driving F1. So even though you can't see the air, we know pushing a car through it still causes some friction because it's got drag. Some air molecules get stuck near the surface in what's called the boundary layer. Meanwhile, the faster flowing air tries to follow the curved shape of the roof and rear window in what's called an attached flow. It would be perfect for the Evo and the Type R if the air smoothly and non-draggily followed the window down, then flowed across the rear wing where it would generate downforce just like it's supposed to. But is that what happens? No! Instead, the attached flow peels off right around the end of the roofline and becomes a separated flow, dispersing off into the atmosphere where you can't even use it. That's why raindrops don't always blow off your back window when you're cruising down the freeway. There's just a swirling mess of turbulence. And that's not gonna make any downforce when it gets to the wing. However, if VORTEX generators are placed in the stagnant area around the trailing edge of the roof where the air starts to separate, they, yes, generate vortices off of their tips, and that helps draw the fast-moving air down into the boundary layer, which keeps the airflow attached for longer. So VORTEX generators are there on the Evo and Type R to make sure air passes over the rear wing and generates downforce. Aerodynamics. Thanks to Skillshare for sponsoring this episode. Skillshare is an online learning community with thousands of classes in design, business, technology, and more. You want to impress your friends? Well, take the basics of Photoshop by Meg Lewis. Premium membership gives you unlimited access to high-quality classes on must-know topics so you can improve your skills, unlock new opportunities, and do the work that you love. Look what I did! I fixed my complexion! Look how smart I look! Skillshare is also more affordable than most other learning platforms out there. An annual subscription is less than $10 a month. The first 500 people to sign up with the link in the description will get the first 2 months for free. That's 20 bucks! So go to skl.sh/sciencegarage3 or click on the link in the description. Skillshare! Subscribe to Donut. The more people who subscribe, the more cool stuff we get to do for you. Follow us on Instagram and Twitter at Donut Media. You can follow me at BitsBardo. Talked about the Civic Type R, you can check out the new car show where James drives one around. You guys want to see the blockbuster episode that started it all? Check out Aero Part 1. Don't tell my wife that I'm keeping the olds.